Let's get the Word of God. Amen. Are you ready for the Word of God? Before I start, remember I passed out those green sheets. If you have them, the green cards, I need them today and I need them Sunday. So if you don't have them today, bring them Sunday. Amen. Because we're going to pray for them. I'm going to seal this 2017 envelope. We're going to pray for them, anoint them, which you desired for the year. We're going to put them in here, and we're going to open them at the end of the year of 17. Now, if you were not here Sunday to receive one, then we have some. So make sure that you get some, and they're right here, a green card. And make sure you fill it out. Make sure you remember what you fill out. But either way, you will know it's in your heart. Write down what's in your heart according to those four questions. Write them down. It's out of your heart, and then we're going to put them. I'm really feeling a strong sensing about this. People have said that they've received so much by praying in faith. See, this is literally putting our belief in faith, our goal for the year, what we're desiring before God. We're being foolish before Jesus. We're being childish. And that's the way to be. Children will be childish, and they will believe when daddy says, we'll go around the world if you want to. They'll believe you. Amen. I tell my grandchildren, we're going to go to Mexico. Mexico. I said, okay, we'll go to Hawaii. Hawaii. So you know what? We're going to go. Amen. So that's the goal that we're going to do. Amen. Hallelujah. So I need them tonight or I need them Sunday. And everybody says, yes, sir. Because I'm closing it. And once I'm closing it, you're out of the picture. You're not in it. Amen. The reason why I'm saying this is because this is so clearly a direction from the Holy Ghost. Amen. Say with me, amen. I did that last year, and a couple of people were hard-hearted. They didn't want to do it. They thought that was ridiculous. Well, they didn't get anything done. And then you wonder, why it didn't happen? Well, they just didn't believe God. Amen. I know quite a few that said, that's kind of ridiculous. Well, we're people that believe. Amen. I believe it. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen? Amen. I love you guys. Amen. Amen? Do you love me? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. And then, of course, Sunday, we're taking Holy Communion. That's exciting. Holy Communion is available for every believer. So we're taking Holy Communion. And then, of course, we're having a powerful service. Jesus is going to be with us. And I'm excited for that. And then after, we're going to celebrate Pastor Christine's birthday. Come on, give the Lord a praise. Amen. She's going to be 58 years old. Did I do it wrong? I was supposed to say it right. All right. And so, I told her, honey, you know, we want to bless you. She said, that's fine. That's fine. Of course, you know, it's very hard to do a surprise party. You know that, unless you really know how to do it. But, you know, in our atmosphere, it's just hard. So we're going to celebrate it Sunday. So we're going to get her some cake and have a great meal and some gift cards and just have a great time and celebrate. Pastor Christine, I know you don't like to use the word first lady. You don't like that because if some reason it makes you think of religiosity of the past and all that. But I'm going to tell you, according to the Word of God, can I tell you something? According to the Word of God, you're a pastor of this house. You are a help to us, to me. And you pastor the church along with me. So we consider you first lady. We consider you one, not necessarily in that sense, but as anointed of God. And so, you know, I know that many times wives, somehow some people take a back seat to it. Like, there's sometimes wives that we know that don't feel united with their husbands. They pastor. I tell you, you got a pastor's wife. You got a pastor that loves the Lord, that worships God, that is 100% with us in church. She believes with us. She preaches. She's a powerful power pack. I'm telling you, you have not seen her in the mission field when she has women conferences or just. And I'm doing this because the Bible says, give honor to whom honor is due. I'm bringing honor unto the Lord, the gifting that's on you. There is a power punch in her. I'm telling you. She had a women's conference and the Moving Forward conference on a Saturday afternoon about 1 o'clock. And I was so delighted to see these women getting set free, delivered. The place is full with people falling on the power of God. Well, on top of the altar. And men were there, but I'm telling you, it was awesome. So I just want to appreciate what you're doing. Other women, for some reason, they feel like, well, you know, my husband's pastoring. I'm sitting in the back seat, you know, in the back row. No. Amen. And let me tell you, for those that are having a hard time receiving from a woman, and I say this out of the Spirit of God, listen, if you're having a hard time receiving from a woman, or if you're in this church or out there, you're missing it. You're missing it. Women are used of God mightily. I receive from women. Billy Brim, I sit under her. Marilyn Hickey, Gloria Copeland, wonderful women of God. I receive so much. So we thank you for that. Amen. We thank you for the gifting of the Lord. Amen. Now, the Holy Ghost had me say that. So for those masculine, oh, my man, no one tells me what to do. Get over with you, old goofy head. Amen. Say with me, amen. I love you. Amen. All righty. Go with me to Matthew, the 9th chapter. Hallelujah. Matthew, the 9th chapter. We began Sunday talking about the call to action, and today in prayer, the Lord confirmed it by the call of action already beginning by intercessory or prayers. Now, notice what he says in the 9th chapter. And again, Father, we ask you to help whoever's these people are going to right now. Be with them in Jesus' name. We speak health, life, protection, and healing in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, Matthew, the 9th chapter, verses 35. Jesus went about the cities and villages teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom of healing every sickness and every disease among them. But when he saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion on them. That's the key that we talked about. Because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Remember, there are a lot of people that have no shepherd. There's a lot of people that have no pastors in their life. They're running rapid, far from God. Now notice what it says. Then said he unto his disciples, verse 37, so you are a disciple. You are now receiving this by the Spirit of God. Then he said this unto us, his disciple. A disciple is one who is disciplined in the word. Not one that is fake and phony and lazy and sloppy in the word. God will never use a person that way. And let me say this, that when God is preparing a person to become a disciple, there's a process that is working on that person. And the process is he's breaking away a lot of outward shells, hardnesses, hearts, attitudes. And that's the first thing he does. And then he comes back and starts working with him. It's like I told Andrew's brother when he went to the Marines. How's he doing anyway? Andrew, how's your brother doing? Are you hearing me? Okay. Amen. Hear me, Andrew, okay? Please hear the message tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. Anyway, that was the Holy Ghost. To ask you a question you couldn't hear. Amen. Woo, Jesus. I love when he does that. Anyway, when the Holy Ghost or when people go to the military to be discipled or, trained, they lose themselves. They no longer are the person. They're no longer the person. You're changed. So, and that's what's happening to his brother and a lot of people that are in the Marines right now that joined boot camp. You got to pray for those young guys that are out there. Amen. This is a disciple. Now, notice what it says here. He says this, and thus said he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous. The harvest truly is plenteous. Now, notice this. Oh, Father, Lord, pray ye therefore for laborers. Come on, church. Let's pray in the Spirit right now. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. All right, let's go back and look at verses 37. Then he said unto the disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest field. So in other words, when you have compassion by praying for people, that is the birthing of compassion by praying. So we have to pray. We have to learn to pray for people. I was one that says, well, I don't need to pray. No, we all have to pray. Jesus said to pray. You pray. When you're having difficulties, there's nothing else that's going to help you. It's going to be prayer. You're having difficulties in family situations, children, whatever, you got to pray. The devil doesn't want you to pray. You got to get on your knees. You got to humble yourself. You got to lay before God and say, God, I'm coming before you. I need help. That's where it's happened. Now, what happens in that process? He puts compassion on you. So, in other words, according to this, there's plenty of crop. Say with me, there's plenty of crop, but not enough hands. Now, notice this. What do we need to do? There's plenty of work, but not enough workers. What do we need to do? We need to pray that he will send workers into the field. Now, what does he do? When you pray for people, most likely you are the ones he's going to use. So he knows when you pray, he uses you. Father, I pray that you send someone to so-and-so in Jesus' name. Bring that person, bring that person. Now, what does he do? He gives you compassion for that person, so now you're taking more compassion to pray, and all of a sudden he starts showing you how to touch that person, how to pray, how to intercede, or how to go talk to that person. It always works. You hate the president, pray for the president. You'll love him. Come on, church, amen. You hate your pastor, pray for your pastor. You'll love him, amen. Come on. You hate your boss, pray for your boss. You'll end up loving him. Well, I'm talking about brotherly love, right? You see what I'm saying? So we have to realize that. Now, we're in a perfect time, folks. We're in a perfect time right now to pray. We're in a perfect time to go forth and do the gathering. We got to stop procrastinating. Say we procrastinating. Tell someone, stop procrastinating. You're being called to action. I'll tell you, if you ever think about it, you need the brother, you need the sister, you need everyone together. We need each other. You know that, right? We need each other. You know what makes the church successful? All of us praying. What makes the church successful? All of us worshiping God all together, not separate, not ignoring the church, not forgetting the church or saying, oh, it's boring. Or we need each other. This is the only time that we gather as the body. The rest, you're by yourself out there with Jesus. Amen. But this is the time that we gather together. Jesus is in here. He's speaking to us. So we're respecting the Lord and saying, yes, sir, amen, speak to me. So what's happening? We need each other. So harvest time, and let me say this real quickly, harvest time is a busy time. Harvest time is a short time. Harvest time must be done. If we pass the season for gathering the harvest, it's too late. Now listen to what I'm saying. If you pass the season for gathering the harvest, it's too late. Because Jesus Christ is going to come, it'll be too late. It'll be too late. You'll be in heaven saying, oh God. And let me tell you something. We don't realize the outcome that we're going to have in heaven when we were told to tell someone about Jesus and we didn't. We don't realize the outcome. The Bible tells us what's going to happen. Now go with me quickly to John, the fourth chapter. Now notice this is reality, church. This is reality. Your being a Christian cost Jesus so much, so now you have to pay the price and tell the world about Jesus. It's going to cost you to tell someone about Jesus. And let me tell you something. If you're saying, well, I'm going to make it to heaven, I'm fine, and I don't need anything else. Well, listen, the Bible says the disobedient will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. So if we've been disobedient to a command, then we're not in the kingdom of heaven. You see what I'm saying? So really the sense is this. If I'm not doing what God's called me to do, I'm disobedient. So now I'm far away from the flow that he has for me. Can you say amen? Now that's real. Say, I love it. Say, I love it. It is so real. I tell you, people say, well, you know, I never heard that before. That's so true because no one teaches that there's consequences of not obeying the kingdom of heaven. You know, if you obey the word of God, you have blessings. And Pastor Christine said something the other day. She says, you know, it's amazing that people are prosperous. And she said something that really, really made me think about something. She says, it's amazing how people can ask things for God and God will honor them, but then they forget about God. Why is it they forget about God? Why is it? Because God loves them and he knows that person has to come to a point in life to make a decision. I'll serve the Lord the rest of my days. You see what I'm saying? So in other words, as a father, I love to bless my children and I will bless them. Even though they curse me, I will still bless them. Even though they hate me, I will still bless them because the principle of love is there. That's the way God operates. But there is a coming that's going to happen that he's going to say, look, you're in heaven, but there was a family that I put you in four different times. Let me show you by the Spirit of God where you missed it. And then you're going to remember, boy, I remember that, Pastor. I remember that, Jesus. I remember that, Jesus. When I was at the 7-Eleven when you said that, and I ignored you. I remember that, Jesus. And that's where we're going to really sense the distance of the reward we're going to get from God. Many are going to get rewards, but not many others will get rewards. And what do we do with rewards? According to Revelation, we're going to lay them before the throne room of God. We're going to say, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Holy, 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 I lay before you the crowns that I have, the treasures that you've given me. You see, because you're honoring the king. Now, notice what it says in John, the fourth chapter, in verses 31. Listen to what it says. It says this. In verses 32, he said this. But he said unto them, I have meat to eat that you know not of. His disciples had no idea that Jesus was mission-minded. They're out to McDonald's, as I may say it, or Kroger's, or H-E-B, whatever it may be. They're out to the store. Therefore said he unto disciples to one another, they said, hath anyone brought him food to eat? And Jesus said unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Then he said this, say not, do not procrastinate that there are yet 4 months and then cometh hours. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes, open your eyes, for the fields are white already now unto harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages. That's you. You're a reaper. You're going to receive wages. You're a reaper. You're going to receive, you're going to gather the fruit of life. Now notice this, unto eternal life. So in other words, while you're reaping, you're giving other people life, eternal life. Listen, if you die right now, you have eternal life forever and ever and ever and ever. But the ones that don't know Jesus don't have eternal life. They have eternal, and let's say it all together, damnation. That's hell. You see, that's far from God. And so our job is always to pray for that person when they don't know Jesus so that we can have compassion for them and pray that someone will minister to them, most likely you will or someone else. Amen. But then he said this in verse 37, and herein is the saying, one soweth and another reapeth. I sent you to reap wherein you bestowed no labor. Other men labored, and you entered into their labor. So in other words, I'm setting it up for you. All you have to do is obey the Holy Ghost. Someone has already planted a seed. Someone has watered, according to a Corinthians. Someone has already talked to them about the Lord. Someone has already ministered to them. So all we have to do now is understand that when you and I tell someone about Jesus, listen to this, someone has already planted a seed or watered it, or you may be harvesting it, or you may be the one planting the first seed. Whatever it takes all of us. Amen. There was a picture of a farmer that they sent it to me from Mexico, one of the pastors that I ministered to years ago. He took a picture. Evidently, he must be watching us about harvest time. So he sent me a picture and a video, and I forgot about it. I was going to send it to my son-in-law so he can put it on there. It's about two boys in the field. One boy is putting seed in the ground, and the boy behind him is just doing this, putting the dirt over. So they don't have combines or automatic planters. In the fields of Mexico, this is what they do. So one little boy is planting seed, and the one behind is putting the dirt over. One's planting, putting the dirt. And they're doing it so fast. The thing that I saw was they're doing a whole furrow. And I thought, oh my God, the acres they got to do, right? Now notice this. That's a combined effort. That little boy behind him is throwing it. They all want seed. See, that's what you and I do. We have combined effort working together. So in other words, when you stop to get gas, and then God says, by the Holy Spirit, I want you to talk to that person pumping gas, and I want you to start the first congregation. Now notice this. The first thing, unless you've never done it before, you're going to say, oh God, I don't want to. I'm so shy. If you've never done it before. But listen to this. God always works when you say, hey, God has a second word. When you say, excuse me, God's already got the second word. You see what I'm saying? So in other words, he needs you as a combined effort. So in other words, that person that you're going to tell about Jesus may have already been prayed for by someone. Grandma's praying for that person. Or maybe that day, the wife is praying for him. We don't know how God works, but we have to recognize there's a combined effort. So in other words, there is a perfect season, and we can't miss the season for in gathering. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Amen. Now, notice what it says. Go with me to Matthew now. Matthew, the 9th chapter. And I get excited when it comes to seeing the workings of the Holy Spirit. Now, Matthew, the 9th chapter. Notice what it says in verse 35. Oh, Jesus, well, tell you what, we read that earlier, right? Yes. Did you say amen? Amen? All right, go with me to Matthew 24. For you that are taking notes, remember, I'm always giving you some more than you write, amen? Notice what it says, that's it right there, verses 24, chapter 24, verses 40, oh God, there's so much. Okay, let's look at 42. Matthew 24, 42. Are you with me? Amen. All right. Watch therefore, for you know not the hour your Lord cometh. You don't know the hour. Say with me, I don't know the hour, but I'm aware he's coming. I don't know the hour, but I sense His return is soon. Now, let me ask you a question before I go on. How many of you sense the return of the Lord is soon? Do you see what I'm saying? You're sensing Him by the Holy Ghost. He's bearing it witness. So you might look at this again. Amen. It says, watch ye therefore, for you not know the hour your Lord doth cometh. But know this, verses 43. Know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. So in other words, if you would have known what time the thief was coming, you're a homeowner, you would never put up with a thief. You would be waiting for that thief. But this is the way it works. Now notice this. Notice what it says here. Therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as you think not the Son of Man cometh. Now let me say something here. For the person that God is telling you to witness to, that person may already be told that Jesus Christ is coming. Maybe they were raised in Bible school, or mama's been praying for them, or daddy's been praying for them. They know they're running from God. Nevertheless, but listen to this. There are still people that don't know Jesus in this world. We have to remember that. There are still children that are not in church, that don't know anything about church, don't know anything about Jesus. Now, the parents may know about Jesus, but never said anything. So you got to remember, there's a generation out there that doesn't know who Jesus is. So that means you have to always think that person that the Holy Spirit's telling you about may never have heard the gospel, or may have heard the gospel. It's not up to you. It's up to you to obey the Lord. You just obey the Lord. Amen. Notice what it says here in verse 44. Therefore, be ye ready, for in such an hour as you think not the Son of Man cometh. Who then is a faithful and wise servant? Who is a faithful and wise servant? Whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household to give them meat in due season. In other words, if you want to be faithful in the kingdom of God, then start working this. Start putting this to work. Ask God to give you boldness. Listen, there are things you can do to learn how to witness, and that's a good thing to do. But the most important thing to do is just being yourself to someone. People know if you're trying to read a format. But if you'll be honest, just be yourself. Think about when someone told you about Jesus. You know, it's amazing how you can start a conversation with anybody when it's of the Holy Ghost. It's amazing. The other day, there was a lady that left her car hurting in pain. She walked in the store, and Pastor Christine was in the store. They passed by each other, and Pastor Christine says, excuse me, can I pray for you? This woman said, honey child, yes, please. And she was hurting going to Walmart. Her legs were so huge, her ankles. And so Pastor Christine, in the middle of the entrance of Walmart, is praying, Father, in Jesus' name, I pray healing. What was this woman saying? She says, yes, Jesus, I agree, Jesus. Yes, Jesus, I agree. And she says, Father, by faith, we receive your healing. You know what she said? Yes, Father, by faith, I receive my healing. And then she says, now, confess you're healed. I'm confessed. This is in the entrance of Walmart. In the entrance of Walmart. Man, I'm telling you, Christine came to the car excited about Jesus. But think about that woman. Think about what she experienced at Walmart. Think about what she said. Oh my God, all that water weight just left her legs. And you know what I'm talking about? God did something. Why? Because His word cannot return void. It must accomplish what it set forth to do. But see, we have to realize we have to be obedient. Now, what if Christine would have said, well, I don't want to. I mean, that's her fault for being that huge, or that's her problem, that would have been demonic. That would have been evil, right? What if that woman would have died that moment? You see, we have to be always available. Not that we're invading, can I say it this way? Not that we're invading their privacy, but you're invading their future life existence. You're thinking about their future. Amen. Now notice what it says here in verse 46. Blessed. Say with me, blessed is the servant whom his Lord when cometh shall find so doing. Verily I say unto that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. So in other words, it's about God. It's about God. Listen, church. It's about God. It's about God seeing our obedience to the Lord. It's about God. Amen. Hallelujah. You see what I'm saying? It's about God. Amen. Amen. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, Father, amen. Amen. All righty. Woo! Jesus. Now notice this. It's about him finding the work of the Lord. It's about him finding. Amen. Intercessors, I want you to pray right now. Prayer warriors, you pray right now in the spirit. Just pray in the spirit right now. Amen. Let me tell you something. The enemy does not want what God is bringing in the spirit. And he'll use flesh to try to hinder this thing. Amen. That's why we got to pray. Listen, when you're hearing the word of God and you sense that there's a stronghold trying to invade it, you pray in the spirit. Amen. Just don't stare like, oh, you know, you pray in the spirit. Amen. What does it do? It moves God to continue moving in the spirit realm. You see what I'm saying? So this is what we do. Amen. And remember, we're in school of ministry, so we learn ministry. You would not learn this in your job. We learn in the church how to operate in the spirit of God in moments like this. Amen. Come on, church. Amen. It's moments like this. Amen. Now notice what he says here. If we will look, now look at quickly in 1 Corinthians, the third chapter. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians, the third chapter. Notice what it says here in verses 5. Who then is Paul? Who then is Paul? So, if I may say it this way, who then is you? Who are you then? And another, it says, who is Paul? And another, I am of Apollos, you are not carnal. Verse 5, then who is Paul and who is Apollos? But both ministers by whom you believed, even as the Lord gave to every man. Now notice what it says in verses 6. I have planted, Paul is saying, I have planted Apollos waters. Here it is again, the working relationship of the ministers of the gospel. In other words, you can never, and this is where pride will bring one down in ministry. Listen to this. If we reach people for the kingdom of God, it's not for us to tell everybody, oh, that's me. That's not your business. Your business is to do the work of God if no one knows. Now, God knows. God knows what you do. And I've seen this in ministry. We're in school of ministry, so really we're learning something. I've seen in school of ministry when people try to toot their horn of the anointing, and God doesn't take glory, he doesn't share that glory of his with no one, then that person falls. I've seen people all the time that will bring someone to church and they'll say, well, you know, Pastor, I bought that person church. They know Jesus because I brought them to church. No, no, no. You didn't bring that person to church. Holy Ghost used you to draw that person to church. If we'll go into that sense now, knowing that the Holy Ghost is working us, now we don't take the glory now. We give it to the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit. Say with me, it's the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit. Amen. It's the Holy Spirit. So in other words, I remember years ago when I started preaching in my father's church, my father would give me little time to preach, you know, just like getting you wet, kind of getting you excited to do things. And I remember getting off the stage and I wanted to get patted. I wanted someone to say, you did good. I wanted my father to say, you did good. And there was a preacher that was there, a senior preacher, a statesman. So I asked him, hey, man, I'm glad you came. Really what I wanted was his shake and his pat in the back. And he said, son, I'm going to tell you something, son. He said, I give God the glory that every word that came out of you was God. And it was God that gave us the message, not you. I got so hurt. I felt so hurt. But he told me something. He said, son, the reason why I'm doing that is because God's going to use you, and you've got to be careful when people come around to try to tell you this and this. Now, the enemy knows that, and he'll try to shut you down. That's why when you lead someone to in Walmart to the Lord, guess what? It's God that gets the glory. It's God that gets the glory. You just say, Father, I thank you, Lord, for this person. Don't start saying, well, that's the number one on my belt. That's number two on my belt, number five. You know, people say, well, I want 30 people to the Lord this year. Now, don't get into that attitude. Well, I want 150 people. Don't get into that attitude. Say, Father, I thank you for giving me the opportunity to win people. The reason why I'm saying this is because, see, we're moving into a higher realm now of witnessing to people, sharing the gospel. And so this is the same thing in pulpit ministry, in prayer ministry, in any area of ministry. It's always important. Now, I want you to see John the 4th chapter. Look at John the 4th chapter. Hallelujah. Come on, hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Father. John, the fourth chapter, verses 28. Now, notice what it says here. Now, this is a story about Jesus talking to a woman at a well. All right? This is the woman that had five husbands, but the one that she was with was not her husband, so she was living with men. So, in other words, she was considered an outcast of that area, of that city. But Jesus sent his disciples away to go get food. They wanted some food. Jesus decided to stay by the well because he had a mission, and he was going to minister to a woman that he needed to reach for a kingdom. Now, here is a woman that people looked down, but Jesus looked at her as a blessing. The world looked at her as a bad woman, and God says, "I want you to minister to her." Now, notice what it says here. Notice what it says here. Hallelujah. Now, where was I going? Verse 28. That woman that we're talking about left her water pot, went her way into the city, and said unto men. Now, this is what the Holy Spirit showed me now. If he would have, in the New Testament, she could have easily said, and the city. Because we read Sunday that the man at the in the Gadarenes told the city about Jesus. But here, she told what? Altogether. Man, now come on, church, be with me. Man, say with me, man. Amen, man of that city. Of that city. Man of that city. She was able to witness to some man. Now, what men were they? Of the city. Chances are they might have been the men she might have lived with. It might have been men that would try. Well, let's just go on. Amen. Oh, you see what I'm saying? Come on, church. Amen. Amen. And the women left her water pot, went her way into the city, and said unto the men, "Come, see a man which told me all things that I ever did. Is not this the Christ?" Question mark. In other words, she planted a seed of Jesus to these men. Now these men came. Now notice what this. Then they went out of the city and came unto Jesus. In the meantime, while his disciples prayed, saying, "Master, eat." He said unto them, "I have meat to eat that you know not of." These disciples missed it. They missed the opportunity of reaching the city, especially men or women, whatever. In fact, they probably saw this woman. She was a Samaritan. And in fact, the Samaritans do not hang around with Jewish people. And the Jewish people do not hang around Samaritans. So in other words, if they would have saw her, they said, "Let's just go on. Let's go to Walmart or whatever store you want to talk about. Buy for less, whatever." Amen. Now notice this. That means God had a plan for her, for her future involvement in ministry. And notice this, if you study scripture very closely now, you see that ministry has invaded this area where this lady lives. And now you see the gospel there. Now you see Jesus. Now let me give you some insight. Wherever Jesus went, there was an open door for the gospel of the disciples to come in. Now remember, the disciples came going out two by two. There was a time 72 disciples left two by two, going to teach about the kingdom of God. Even his disciples, they went out. To this day, we thank God that the disciples brought the gospel to Europe, and that's how we got the gospel through Europe. So in other words, we thank God for the writings of Paul. But wherever Jesus went, he opened the door for the gospel. Now, I want you to picture this right now. Where are you at? What's your Decapolis? What's your city? What's your location? What's your neighbor? What's your job? What's your circle of influence? What's your level that you talk to every day of people? Now listen. If you're around 100 people a day, you have an audience that Jesus can come in. If you're around 5 people a day, you've already have 5 people that you can minister. But don't ever think about 5. Think about what they're capable of doing when they receive Jesus. Remember the statistic that we gave you? You reach a mother or you reach a husband, you reach a family. You reach a mother, you reach a children. You reach a teenager, you're going to reach some in school. You reach a college kid, you're going to open a Bible class in college. You see what I'm saying? So you have to realize things work in the multiplication process. So that's what we have to think about. Think about Billy Graham. Who ministered to Billy Graham? And think about the millions and millions of people that he won. I'll give you another one. Think about Paul Youngie Cho, one of the pastors of one of the world's largest church, almost at 900,000 members. He was just a man in the gutter, that was barely surviving, and some missionary from the United States went to Korea and ministered Jesus to Paul Youngie Cho, which is now David Youngie Cho, and ministered to him. He got saved. She discipled him. Now, David Youngie Cho, they have over 7,000 pastors and ministers. And I want you to get a picture. 800 plus thousand members. I saw an aerial view of his Sunday morning worship. 800,000. That's a huge building. It's an arena where 800,000 come, and that's only on one service. That's one service. And we can go on and on and on. But see, it starts with one, doing the kingdom of God. Amen? Now, go quickly. Let's look at something. Go with me to, let's look at, Father, I thank you. Look at John 6. John 6. Amen. And then we're gonna pray, and then we're going to continue this as we continue. Amen. John, the 6th chapter, verses 44. Now, I want you to see this. Let's look at verse 43 now. John 6, 43. Jesus therefore said unto them, murmur not among yourselves. So in other words, he's saying, listen, just stop the bickering. Say with me, stop the bickering. This is where most Christians are. They're trying to put down theology, down people, religion. Religion doesn't save. Theology doesn't save. The only thing that saves is Jesus Christ and his doctrine. Now, notice is the problem with people is, and it's a sad situation. Now, I will be honest with you. Can I be honest even more? You know, you can sense a religious person, religiosity. There's no love, but there's nothing but words. Something's wrong with this picture. Too much law, no love. That right there is a detriment to a new believer. Especially when a new believer... Listen, new believers know they need Jesus. New believers know that they're living a life miserable. You know how people know that without Jesus, you knew you were miserable. You knew you just were without Jesus and just terrible, feeling terrible every morning. They know that. And if you come to someone with religiosity, you just put a wall and you'll never minister to that person again. But if you come with the gospel of Jesus Christ, and notice what it says here in verses 44, no man or woman can come to me, Jesus said this, except the Father which has sent me, Jesus, draw him and I'll raise him up in the last day. You see the working corporation partnership that we have here? You have to think about it. You're a messenger of Jesus. And now you're bringing people to hear about Jesus, but now the Holy Spirit now is working with you and using words. There's times that you'll say things that you didn't know you were going to say it, and that's Holy Ghost. Just like I preach to you, there's times that I can sense the anointing just takes my words, and I know God's here because my words are just shifting. And I'll tell Pastor, my goodness, the Holy Ghost was there. You can feel the possession of the Holy Ghost. That's what the Holy Ghost does when you step out in faith. You get possessed of the Holy Ghost with the word of faith. You know, say, and so what happens is, you know, like Pastor Christine prayed for that lady that was in Walmart. She brought healing to her, brought Jesus, brought unity, brought confirmation of healing, and no telling. And I told Christine, she must have been a believer. She's agreeing with you. Yes, in Jesus' name. So she knew how to agree. So the thing about that was Holy Ghost led her to pray these prayers. And that's what's happened. That's what happens. There's times the Holy Ghost, I'll give you a good example. We're going to go in a little bit, all right? I'll give you an example. We went to a church in Latin America, and I was an interpreter for my pastor. I remember I'm young, learning how to preach. I'm an interpreter. Lord gave me the language to speak Spanish. I never knew how to speak Spanish, so I'm interpreting. Not 100% clear, but I'm interpreting. And all of a sudden, my pastor said, in the middle of the sermon, he stopped, and he said, in this house, there's a woman that I need to pray for, Pastor. And we can't go further. And I'm interpreting because I'm saying in Spanish, and the pastor's back there. And then he said, Pastor, I have to say this, but I need to tell you, but I need to release this to the church, but I need to tell you first, because you're the head of this pastor. The house, I have to tell you. He went to his ear, so I went with him, and oh my God, he said, there's a member in this house that is in pain. Emotional pain. She had an abortion. he told the pastor that, and I'm interpreting that. Oh my God. I'm interpreting this. I said, oh my God, my pastor could get hung now. And I'm thinking, dear Lord, and you should have seen me. Blah, 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 you know? And so finally the pastor starts crying. He starts to cry. Oh, he's crying. And then he gets up and he says, he gets me by the shoulders. Would you tell Pastor, I want my wife to come up here. Oh, and he calls his wife up there and they're crying. And Pastor says, okay, release it. He tells him, release it. So he says, there's no young lady in here. And it turns out to be the daughter of this pastor. And notice what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. Holy Ghost is so powerful. So what happened? The church now is hearing this. Pastor says, I got to confess. My daughter got pregnant. We sent her to the United States to get an abortion. The church came to the altar running and hugged the pastor's wife, the daughter. There was such a healing of emotion, healing. And the woman, the young girl got delivered. She was just living in misery. You can imagine the pastor. Well, the pastor told us later on the church suffered because there was that sin in the church, but they didn't know how to deal with it and they were embarrassing. And so what happened? God, by the Holy Ghost, that used my pastor to be bold, to step out of faith. He could have easily ignored this. Brought healing to the whole church. I tell you, there was healing, crying and healing and loving each other and forgiving each other. And then God had to put a golden touch on the service. He told this lady, he said, come here, young girl. He said, in 2 years, you will be married. And after a year, you will be pregnant and you will have a boy and his name will be David. Laid hands on her, she fell out in the power of God. And the church is rejoicing, right? Church is rejoicing, right? Guess what? We go back to Bible college about 4 years later. And guess who came to that Bible college? Was the father, the pastor, with his family and her daughter and her husband and a little boy named David. You see what the Holy Ghost does? Now give the Lord our praise. Amen. Now notice this. Why am I saying this? For my pastor to release that word, it didn't start that moment. It started by him pumping gas at 7-Eleven and hearing God to speak to someone. It started by him telling someone about Jesus, and then now the Holy Ghost uses him. So what's happening? It's building confidence in the Holy Ghost. Now the Holy Ghost is using you to a greater degree. Now that happened. I learned a lesson. Holy Ghost knows everything about everything. If you will allow the Holy Ghost to use you, there's a world out there that's hurting like that young girl. God can use you out there to bring healing in Jesus' name. And think about what that young lady could be, or that young man or whatever could be a mighty person. Amen. Go ahead and stand up, church. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus is so good. Say with me, He's so good. Hallelujah. Amen. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank You for the Holy Ghost. We thank You for the working of Your Spirit. We thank You, Jesus, that You are Lord. Amen.